Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Dane Holmes, the head of Human Capital Management, and it's my pleasure today to be joined by Scott Harrison, who's the founder and CEO of Charity Water. And for a moment about Charity Water, it's an organization whose mission is to provide water to the nearly 663 million people in the world who don't have access to it. He also talked about this in his book, Thirst, which is a story of redemption, compassion, and a mission to bring clean water to the world. And so, Scott, thank you for being here. It's great. So let's start off. Let's get right. You know, we're going to talk about your childhood right away. So you were in somewhat of a pretty constrained or reserved environment.
Yeah.
And what role did that play for you in your early career path of kind of musician and club promoter? What led to that?
Well, it was a family tragedy first. I was born in Philadelphia, middle class family. My dad was a business guy. My mom was a writer for the local paper. And when I was four, we moved into a drab gray house. I remember on this little cul-de-sac to reduce his commute. And we moved into the dead of winter. Unknown to all of us, the house had a carbon monoxide gas leak. Mm-hmm. So we all start getting sick. We develop these symptoms. My mom, on New Year's Day, passes out unconscious on the floor.
Jeez.
Take her to the hospital, and after the blood test, they find the mass amounts of carbon monoxide in her bloodstream. So she's never the same again. Mm-hmm. She becomes an invalid overnight.
Yeah.
Immune system shuts down, and from this point on, anything chemical makes her sick. So family planning stops. I'm now thrust into a caregiver role at four. Yeah. My parents are, you know, very deep Christians. They decide not to sue the gas company, which shocks all of their friends because they thought they could have gotten millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And, you know, I grow up taking care of mom, doing the cooking, doing the cleaning, playing piano every Sunday in church.
Yeah.
Rules-based environment. I wasn't allowed to do much.
Yeah.
And then at 18, I just, you know, had this aha moment. I only lived an hour and a half from the city. And I said, now it's my turn. Now it's time to go nuts. And I grew my hair down to my shoulders. I joined a rock band. The plan at that time was to play sold out amphitheaters, you know, around the world and, you know, open up for U2 and the like. That lasted about
very close to that.
Lasted about 2 months. We broke up because we all hated each other. But we did play CBGBs and some cool clubs.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I came across this job, which I'm sure no one here knows anything about, called a nightclub promoter, where I learned that if you could get the right people inside the right clubs, you could charge them $20 for a cocktail.
Yeah.
You could sell a bottle of champagne for $1,000
that
only costs $50. Yeah. And, you know, I thought, well, if I'm going to rebel, I'm going to do it in style. So my new ambition became, I want to be the king of New York City. I want to be the guy up in the DJ booth spraying Cristal, you know, across the throng of people at 3 a.m.
Very close to your Christian choir.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, my parents, like, we're not having any of this, but they couldn't really do anything about it. And I remember starting at clubs at 18, 3 years before I was legally allowed in.
So you were doing it that young, at 18?
I was working for Peter Gation at this place called Limelight and the
Rock and Roll Church.
Tunnel. Yeah, it's like a shopping mall now.
Yeah.
Lots changed. So long story short, I spent the next 10 years climbing up New York's social ladder to try and become this, you know, king of nightlife. I worked at 40 clubs.
40.
Over that time. And the, you know, nightclub promoters are just guns for hire. You're asset light, you roll in, you bring the people. You know, you take 15, 20% of the total take, and when the venue isn't cool anymore, you just take all your people and your list and you go to the next place. Because everybody gets bored every 9 to 18 months, depending on the cycle.
Wow.
So 40 clubs. Now, I also pick up every vice you might imagine would come with the territory to the chagrin of my parents. I'm smoking 2 packs of Marlboro Reds.
Wow.
My doctor just recently said, wow, you did 20 pack years. I didn't even know that that was an expression.
Yeah, that's not a metric.
10 years of two packs a day, drinking problem, gambling problem, pornography addiction, strip club problem, coke, MDMA, ecstasy. I mean, pretty much anything short of mainlining heroin. You know, I'm doing mainly out of boredom at this point because it's just a really boring job.
It
seems great at first, but you're shouting over the DJ, the same people, the clubs change, but it's all the same. And you know, I my life looked great on the outside. I drove the BMW. I had the nice loft in New York. I had a the Rolex watch. I had the, you know, Labrador Retriever, all these things, that the markers of success. So all the markers of success that I thought would bring happiness. Yeah. And it just hit me, you know, I had this cathartic moment at 28 years old. I was in South America in Punta del Este with all the beautiful people, and we'd rented this compound with servants and waiting on us, and magnums of Dom Perignon, and horses in the backyard, and a yacht that, you know, was attached to the house, and all of the things that I had been chasing for 10 years. And I realized that I was rotting on the inside. So there was a realization that it wasn't a pivot that was needed. You know, I didn't need to make kind of a small course correction. Yeah. I needed like the 180, I needed to start walking home.
Yeah.
The 180 degree turn.
Yeah.
And I would need to quit all of the vices. I just kind of saw that coming. You know, I would have to quit smoking and drinking and drugs and gambling and porn and all that. And just kind of. So I have this turn, and the opposite for me, the only really kind of flesh on opposite idea was, what if I sold everything I owned, started life over, and applied for a humanitarian service. And I applied to the famous humanitarian organizations I've tangentially heard of over the years, the Red Cross and Oxfam and Save the Children and World Vision, Salvation Army. No surprise, probably, no one will take me.
Yeah. Club promoter to humanitarian.
My resume does not read uniquely qualified. So I'm so frustrated because I know how to get 2,000 people in a club. I know how to queue outside a velvet rope, you know, and pick the right people, at least I thought, through the one-way glass and ring up $50,000 or $60,000 of booze in a couple hours.
Yeah.
And no one will allow me serve for free. So finally, one organization writes me back and says, well, if I'm willing to pay them $500 a month to volunteer, and if I'm willing to go live in post-war Liberia, then I can join them.
Yes,
like, perfect.
Exactly right.
Like, what's more
the opposite of war pay? Yes.
What is more opposite than poorest country in the world at the time? Yeah. Liberia had fallen off of the UNDP charts because there was no data during the 14-year civil war, and then I would have to pay them. So I signed up, said yes, start paying them $500 a month, and then I set foot in Africa for the first time in the fall of 2004 in this completely broken country. No electricity, no running water, no sewage, no mail system, one doctor for every 50,000 citizens. A country that had just been broken by a decade and a half of Charles Taylor and his child soldiers.
Yeah.
And I was there operating on a 522-foot hospital ship that had sailed in, pulled in at port, and the idea is we brought great doctors from all over the world, and we were going to help as many people get access to medical care as needed.
Yeah.
And I was gonna be documenting everything that happened.
Yeah, and so you were a photographer during that.
Yeah, it was a year that turned into two.
Yeah.
And my friends on the list, or they went from getting invitations to the Prada megastore, you know, party to tumors and leprosy and flesh-eating disease and cleft lips and cleft palates. And I was surprised at how many people cared.
Yeah.
So I learned that maybe the same storytelling skills that had been misused or used for dubious world good, and even that list of some of those contacts could be used to profile this life-changing, transformative work by these humanitarians. So the year turned into two. It was really on the second year that I stumbled across the water crisis.
Yeah. Why water? How did water become?
Well, most of my job was just spent pre-op, post-op documenting the surgeries. We would put thousands of people through the medical wards. We had a 42-bed, state-of-the-art hospital. We had three operating theaters, you know, MRIs, CT scans.
Yeah.
So most of the first year we spent on the ship. The second year I got off of the ship and I went into the rural areas of Liberia and I saw the water that people were drinking. And for the first time in my life, I saw human beings, children, drinking from swamps.
Yeah.
You know, brown, green, viscous water that was alive with parasites, with worms in it. Mm-hmm. And I learned that 50% of the country, 50% of the people living in Liberia were drinking disgusting, contaminated water.
Yeah.
So I start sharing, you know, in stark contrast to me, a couple months earlier, I was selling Voss for $10 a bottle.
Yeah, exactly.
In clubs, to people who wouldn't even open the water. They would come in, they would order a bunch of champagne and some, you know, vodka, and then they would just order water for show and let it sit there. So I'm watching kids die of diarrhea.
Yeah.
and half the country is drinking bad water. So I'm sharing this with the doctors, and you know, long story short, they encouraged me to go work on this issue. They said, look, 52% of all the disease throughout the world at the time,
right,
half of the hospital beds, I remember the stat clearly, half of the people in all the hospital beds in the world were in those hospital beds because they had dirty water. So he said, if you really care about health, maybe rather than helping us fundraise for the next $100 million hospital ship that helps a few thousand people, why don't you go work on the then billion people living without access to clean water?
Yeah, let's spend a little bit of that on water, because this is the part that I found most interesting. So there's the obvious health part of it. Yep. Hey, water's part of life. But it's tied to a bunch of other issues, too.
It's like this onion that you keep going back. So you all know the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. Water now has its own standalone goal, but it touches four or five others. And you know, if you think about, it's so hard for us because we don't ever go without water. I mean, anybody listening, like, when's the last time you've been thirsty? You know, you run a marathon and there's water at every step along the way. So water's just a part of our life. Maybe, you know, if in our high-rise building they turn it off for 2 hours, you know, oh my gosh.
Yeah, what am I going to do? No shower right now.
For 2 hours. But, you know, if you're one of the people living without access to water, you mentioned today it's 663 million people, it affects every aspect of your life.
Yeah.
I'll talk about education. So it deeply impacts girls' education. So people don't know this, but one out of every three schools on the planet not only doesn't have clean water, it doesn't have a toilet. So imagine sending your kid to a school with no water and no toilet. So if you're a teenage girl, you don't go to school for 4 or 5 days every month. You're ashamed to go to a school with no water, with no sanitation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So what we see is this, many of the girls drop out because not only culturally do they have to walk for water, it is the role of the women and the girls worldwide to walk for that water and to provide it. But there's no water and sanitation at the school. So huge impact on education.
Yep.
I mean, there's data to prove this. A huge education on a huge impact on women in time.
Yeah.
You know, 40 billion hours are wasted by women just in Africa every year, walking for water. 6 hours a day, 7 hours a day, 8 hours a day. It's not a Monday through Friday gig, too, because if you don't walk for water Saturday and Sunday, your family goes without. So, you know, imagine 50 hours a week dedicated to then walking to unharmful water. It's not even clean.
Yeah,
you're not walking to a well.
Yeah.
You're walking to a swamp or a river. Because maybe the source dried up in the dry season near you, and you're going, you're a woman, you're at risk of rape on these long walks, you're at risk of hyena attacks, lion attacks. I was recently with women in Malawi and in Kenya that were complaining about crocodile attacks, naming their friends who had come to get water at a river and were dragged off by crocodiles. If you give birth, you're giving birth by this water source hours away from your home. So all of this, you know, all the stuff that has a huge, huge impact on women and girls specifically, health, as you mentioned, and then the local economy. The UN came out with a powerful study that found every dollar you invest in water and sanitation makes the community $4 to $8 richer. So dollar equals 4 to 8x, and there's data behind this. It's an 88-page paper if you guys are interested. Two researchers, Hutton and Haler. They found in some of the most extreme environments, they got a 20x economic benefit.
Wow.
So imagine putting $1 million into water and sanitation facilities and making the community $20 million richer on par.
Yeah, that's amazing. So let's talk a little bit about your organization. So you come up, you were a club promoter, as you self-described, you know, you're a hired gun. But now you got to build this organization. And, you know, you kind of started with three of you. You now have 100 employees or more. Talk about going from a hired gun to a leader of an organization and a disciple of a kind of a change movement around water. How did you navigate that?
You know, I had the fortune of being in the 9/10, born into the middle class, and I've never had dirty water to this day. Yeah. When I go out, I have filters with me. I've got, you know, I can afford bottled water. One out of 10 people on the planet, not that. So if I could use the rest of my life to take the billion down to 663 million now, take it down to zero, that's what I wanted to do. So I also then had the advantage of having no philanthropic experience. I have never worked at a charity before. I've just run around as a photojournalist with these doctors for 2 years. So I don't really know how you're supposed to start a credible humanitarian organization. So I'm talking to friends in finance, friends at MTV, friends in, you know, in fashion and in news, and I realized that to do what I want to do is going to be incredibly difficult because most people don't trust charities. There's a huge cynicism, a disenchantment. Yeah. I came across a USA Today poll that found 42% of Americans don't trust charities. Yeah. More recently, NYU polled America. 70% of Americans said they believed charities wasted their money. So I thought to actually accomplish the mission to bring clean water to everybody on the planet, we would have to raise so much capital and create such a movement that we would need the 42%. Yes. We would need the 70%. So I started asking them why they don't give. And I kept hearing the same recurring themes and created a very unique model at Charity Water where you know, from day one, we said, we're going to give away 100% of all public donations directly to fund water projects and get people clean water, whether somebody gives $10 or $10 million, all public money. And then in a separately audited bank account, I'm going to raise the overhead separately. Yep. I'm going to hopefully find 30, 50, 100 families to get excited about paying those 100 staff, the office in Tribeca, the flights and that. So 100%, we'll be so crazy about this, we'll pay back credit card fees. Even this to this day, if you went online and gave $10,000 on your American Express, sadly, I get $9,700 like every other charity. Yeah. We pay back the 3%. We send $10,000 that you intended to the field. So the first kind of pillar was 100%.
Yeah.
So you couldn't use the excuse of how much of my money will get there.
Yeah.
All of it.
Yeah.
The second was to use technology to prove what we did with that money. Mm-hmm. We heard from donors that when I give to a charity, they just keep asking me for money. I don't get a sense of impact. And we said, well, we're building water projects and rainwater harvesting systems and gravity-fed systems and filter systems and wells. Let's show people where they all are. Let's build the most hyper-transparent charity the world has ever seen. So we started 12 years ago. Charity Water and Google Earth started at the same time. So we started just putting up every water point on Google Earth, later Google Maps, showing people the satellite images of the project. So you can see our wells via satellite, know that the water project. And then we started sending that info to the donors. The third thing was this idea of building an epic and imaginative brand. So I wanted to build that kind of charity that was based on hope and opportunity, inspiration, imagination, not, you know, and was design focused. And we would hire the best designers from the Twitters and the Teslas of the world, you know, or the Apples of the world, to use their design skills in the service of humanity.
Yep.
And then the most important thing is we wouldn't send anybody that looked like me over to Africa or India to dig a well.
Yeah.
I believe for any of the actual water work to be sustainable and culturally appropriate, it must be led by the locals.
Yeah.
So our role would be build a movement, raise capital as efficiently as possible, but then empower the locals and grow their organizations. They would get the credit.
Yeah.
Our local partners in India would be the ones planting the flag of their local NGO with our funding, with our drilling rigs that we gifted them, with the trucks that we helped them buy, the office we helped them expand into. But they would be the ones flying the flag of development, not some Western foreigner organization.
The one other thing that I thought's been amazing about it that I know has had a little bit of controversy around it too is this idea of having people donate their shares. Talk to me about how you thought about that creatively, because it's just something that I haven't seen many other places. That's once again kind of
sure. Well, one of the biggest challenges is keeping the 100% model intact, right? So if you all in this room and people watching responded and said, "Hey, here's $10 million," can't use a single penny of that to pay an employee at Charity Water, office, a flight, any of that. All that would go straight to the field and go build 1,000 wells or 1,000 water projects, let's say. So that's always this tension from a business model approach. We could become insolvent.
Yes.
With $100 million of public money in the bank and miss payroll.
Yeah.
Okay, so from a business model approach, that is a scary thing. Now, we are very focused. We have tons of metrics around working capital and three-year commitments from our donors, all that kind of stuff. So that's one challenge, is raising that capital. And then the second one is I am competing against Twitter, Facebook, Google for talent, not the IRC or World Vision or Oxfam. I mean, we're hiring UI, UX designers. We're hiring software engineers. We're hiring, you know, the water engineers in some ways are very easy. So one of the things, one of the levers tech has always had to offer is the shares, right? Be a part, be the next engineer, they could be a millionaire.
Yeah.
Like happened at Twitter or Facebook or, you know, or so many of these companies.
Yeah.
So hanging out, getting to hang out and having support from so many of the founders of Twitter and Facebook and WeWork and, you know, early Uber employees, we started talking, you know, saying, well, what if your shares could not only help me keep the 100% model capitalized, but also create a new equity program for my employees so that I could use that to recruit and retain talent the same way you are. So we have created this giving program where if you answer the phones and maybe, you know, come in at an entry level salary, you could be eligible for a 50% bonus on your salary. We have weighted it so that our lowest paid employees get the highest percentages and we've capped it among execs and I'm exempt.
Yeah.
So I can never benefit from a single share that I raise. So if I raise $1 billion for the program, I can't make a penny from it. So instead of the rich getting richer,
you continue at a nonprofit,
we're trying to
way. It's promotion in a different way.
It is. And if you vest over time, up to 10 years. So if you're with us for 8 years, your access to that pot, which we call the pool, is greater than if you just came in at year one. So I want to pay our employees better. They are making sacrifices. They could be making $50,000 to $100,000 more at these, you know, at the Facebooks and Googles, because I still have to be efficient. I still have all these, you know, I've still all got all these salary bands and stuff that I have to conform to. So this is just a way, it's just another lever. No one's going to become a millionaire at Charity Water, but, you know, you might be able to take an extra vacation. You might be able to support your family, you know, do something for your kids that you weren't able to do.
Yeah.
Based on some of these successful IPOs.
That's great. Well, Scott, I want to thank you for coming. It's a pleasure.
Thanks
I
for really having
appreciate
me.
Appreciate it. We'll see you soon.
Thank you.